Welcome back, everyone, and welcome to the second Southeast Asian game of the day. This will finish off our Southeast Asian division for today. We've got a few more games over the coming weeks, and it's pretty much open. Anyone outside of the bottom two, I believe, can still find themselves that last grand final spot, or the one grand final spot, and there are still three or four places left for staying in the MLG Pro League itself as well. So any team, pretty much. These games mean a lot to these teams. Try and get as many points and as many wins as they can. Let's head over to the draft and welcome in Scant, my co-caster. What do you think about these two teams?
Well, it's interesting. We were saying last game, if you look at the log for this tournament, Rave at 8-6 and Mineski at 6-8, but Rave are like currently 4th and Mineski at 9th. There's very little between these teams, as you were saying. I think that there actually is a lot more than that between them. I mean, even though they're close in the log, I feel like Rave should be big favorites in this match.
Yeah. Rave have been one of those teams that have really, you know, played into that MLG draw league thing. They lose game one strangely or in a weird fashion, and then game two, they're just like, well, I guess we have to play properly, guys. I don't know what it is. They just seem like they need to warm up before they start playing these games. But nevertheless, I'm not sure if Mineski can still make it out here. So they're 6-8. That's what, 14 of their games played out of 18. So they could potentially go 10-8 here. So maybe they, like, if MVP lose the rest of their games, actually, I'm not sure how this works. Maybe Mineski can't actually get to that top spot, depending on who MVP play against. Whether it's, like, you know, trust, if they get two wins against MVP. But I don't know. I'm pretty sure Mineski are out of the running for the final spot, but can still find themselves staying in the Pro League.
Yeah, so plenty to play for. And first pick Batch Rider here for Rave. The other thing you're saying, that Rave needing to warm up, often losing the first game, winning the second. The other thing is that there's that Bristleback thing, where they just seem to always lose against that hero. So I'm always interested to see, maybe Mineski pick up the Bristleback in this game. Maybe they're aware, maybe teams have noticed that that's a hero that's doing well against Rave in general.
Rave have also suffered the fact that the last couple of series they've been missing J.O., and they've had someone standing in for him, SEL, I believe. And they brought in a support stand-in to replace J.O., so then they had to switch, like, Ninja Boogie onto the one role and, you know, change things around a little bit to try and fit people into different roles. But it didn't work too badly for them. It's just the fact that it seemed they were missing that one guy, J.O., who is, you know, probably the most experienced player on this team. The fact that he used to play for some of the big American teams a couple of years ago at TI2, TI3?
Yeah, I think it was TI2. Was he playing for EG at TI2, or was he playing for Team Liquid? I actually don't remember. I think he was playing for EG.
I can't remember now. Because he was playing with Hannah Montana and those guys, didn't he? Or was it EG? Oh my god. I can't remember that far back. Was it?
He actually played with both of them, that's the thing. So he played in Complexity with Hannah Montana and them.
Yeah.
And after that, he joined EG.
So it was TI2 with Complexity and then TI3 with EG. It must have been.
Yeah, I think so.
TI3 was the last one that Melk was still playing with EG as well, and that was when J.O. was still there? That was a long time ago now, in those terms.
Yeah, and there was a TI that EG didn't go to. I think it might have been TI3. I'm not sure. Was it TI2?
I don't know. EG wasn't at one of the TIs?
Yeah.
Oh, boy. Poor EG.
I remember there was a whole thing about how EG was doing this whole PR thing about how Dota's not just TI. There's other big tournaments. It's fine. We're winning North American events.
Oh, well. Anyway, J.O. has found himself now in South Korea playing with a bunch of players. They're mainly Filipino, but they've got a couple of other guys in there as well. Picking up the Batrider and Antimage is their first 1-2. Both heroes very good at taking down Queen of Pain in a succinct fashion. Just jump on her, lasso, hit her a couple of times, then Mana Void. Her mana pool is going to get ripped apart, but also the fact that she's got limited armor, her HP pool isn't that great. She's the one that wants to be the aggressor, rather than the one being caught out.
And I want to say that the early pick Anti-Mage is a statement of intent. We're going to be farming. But at the same time, a few of these Anti-Mages in this tournament, in SEA in particular, we've seen them being quite active early on. We saw Cures, Anti-Mage all around the map, ganging, fighting. I think FZFZ's anti-mage as well was pretty aggressive, although he got the farm first. And you, I think you even told me that you saw, who was it? Was it Virtus Pro or CIS team running the Vanguard? Hellraisers?
Hellraisers, yeah.
So maybe it's becoming more and more possible that the anti-mage doesn't have to just be that farmer. So I'm not sure if it necessarily says, hey, we're farming.
Yeah, depending on what item build you go, it definitely can fit into multiple roles. I mean, there have been occasions when anti-mage has gone mid. I think it was Mushi about a year and a half ago that was toying with that idea. The fact you can blink onto runes and have a bottle to keep yourself sustained. Trading hits with the mid heroes back then was a little bit easier because the majority of them were melee heroes. You know, Beastmaster, Brewmaster, all of the masters. You just jump up to them. Just hit them a couple of times. Their mana pool gets ripped to shreds. But nowadays, with the majority of ranged nuking heroes like Quap, Shadowfiend, Storm Spirit, he can't really go there.
Yeah, a lot of heroes that we've seen banned in the previous series getting through quite far, well, Sniper in particular, not being picked in the first phase, not being banned in the first or second phase.
Juggernaut?
Yeah, Juggernaut.
I mean, this is something that Nahas and I were talking about, you know, Juggernaut, Axe, Troll. In Europe and North America, they're all really top picks. They're like banned out in the first phase or picked in the first phase. But in Southeast Asia, Juggernaut is almost completely ignored. Like, actually never gets seen. Sometimes it's picked up by a team kind of randomly. Like, hey, look, there's a Juggernaut. We can kind of fit that into our draft. But it's not seen as that overpowered hero.
Well, an instant Wisp pick as soon as the second pick phase started and a fast AA response. I'm not sure about this with Wisp pick. I mean, it's hard to say there's a bad matchup for Wisp ever, but if there is a bad matchup for Wisp, it looks like it's this one.
Wisp Bristle incoming? Question mark?
Well, Bristleback's good against Rave, but they go for the Wisp Tiny, which is the fairly standard build. And Tiny's quite a good carry against Anti-Mage, actually. It normally forces the Anti-Mage to buy a BKB, otherwise you can't really fight against that craggy exterior.
Yeah, he does get annoyed by that quite a bit. But Tiny Wisp is always one of these combinations that you need to address either in the draft or you need to make things happen early on in the game. Because I guess because they're Radiant, there isn't that massive threat of, you know, the double or triple camps being stacked up for the Tiny to just go and avalanche toss. But you still have to make sure that you know when Tiny's getting his Aghanims, how far ahead he is, or, you know, what stage he is in his progression through into that Aghs. Because once he gets that, things start getting really difficult. If Anti-Mage doesn't get the same quality and quantity of farm up on his safe lane, Tiny and Wisp could run away with this game.
Yeah, and I like the response from Mineski in the sense that the early Anti-Mage pick does kind of suggest you're going to do a defensive tri-lane. And then Mineski saying, well, fine, we're going to do some dual lanes and we're just going to get better value than you.
Brewmaster banned out there, so Rave have two supports and the AM. Offlane Batrider. So it looks like Mineski are looking to ban out some mid heroes, but Brewmaster isn't really one that comes to mind when I think of Rave and the lineup they've currently got. Maybe they could even pick up something like a Medusa here, possibly. Sure, it doesn't really, you know, come online early to try and fight into people, but is that what Rave want to do? They've got AM. They've got defensive support. Well, relatively defensive supports. They can keep their lanes safe from any aggression from Mineski. If they go for something, you know, a tanky carry like that, I don't see them having too much trouble. Storm Spirit is still there for Chrissy, though. If they've got the Storm zipping across with Ice Blast and Lasso, that does give them the opposite side of the spectrum, where instead of going full on defensive, they can have a mix of both.
I guess there might be a concern that they don't have any... it feels stupid even saying it, but they don't have any tanks.
I dodge that word. I say front, like, I know Toby does it as well. We say frontline heroes because saying tanks is just like, excuse me, this isn't League of Legends. This isn't World of Warcraft. There are no tanks in this game, but you want a frontline brawling hero. A tank.
Most Storm Spirit players like to go into fights second, ideally. You can go in first, but that's why I think they might take something different here, because I guess they've got a Batrider who can go in first, so it's not too bad for Storm. But if you look at Mineski's lineup, it just feels like it's a big... Well, they don't go for a frontliner, but Puck is a hero that can initiate and can be in the fight early on, so performing a similar role.
That's Chrissy Batrider and Rio Puck. Are we going to see Bat mid?
I think we saw Batrider offlane. Did we not see Chrissy playing the bat once before in a previous series? And we were discussing how it's just a similar hero to what he normally does. Then again, Puck is also a similar hero to what he normally does.
That's the thing, because I know they like to switch up their lanes. Ninja Boogie has played offlane and core, depending on, like, he's played mid Tidehunter for them before. When they pick up these, like, specialty heroes for certain players, they do like to switch it up. Jayo, obviously, Anti-Mage, that's his guy. That's his style. Luna and Anti-Mage, Jayo style, takes those heroes, but I don't know. Rio, I've not seen him play mid before, I don't think.
The last series that I cast of Rave was Rave with CSW. And we saw Chrissy offlane Batrider, and actually Rio was playing the mid Viper in that game. It's where Jayo had Medusa. That was the game where they went super far behind and then just made a comeback with the Medusa.
Okay.
So maybe that's what it has to do with as well. It might be that in the games where Jayo plays the super hard carry, like very, very farmy, Anti-Mage does that as well. I mean, he doesn't go as late as Medusa, but he's very farm intense. Maybe for whatever reason in those games, they like to have Chrissy on the offlane Batrider and send Rio down to mid. I mean, it just could be as simple as Chrissy's their best Batrider player. This is what I was saying last time. Yeah. Batrider's a hero that if you've got one player who's extremely good at Batrider, it's very valuable to put them on it, because that's the kind of player who is going to actually make kills in the offlane. If the enemy steps out of position, you know, going to know how to capitalize and how to get the efficient, really fast blink dagger, make the right calls about when to go on people.
How do these other lanes work out, though? Jesse Vash is a pretty tanky hero. 700 HP and 5 armor going into the offlane. But you're dealing with the magic damage of Chilling Touch, Telekinesis, then Mana Burn. There's so much early game magic damage there from the Dire that I'm not sure your armor and HP actually matters too much. They probably won't be able to kill him straight up, but they'll drop him to about 100 HP or 150 before he has to charge away. So Jesse Vash on the Spirit Breaker will have, you know, have to be very careful where he positions himself. But once he hits level 2, he'll probably be looking at that mid lane and going, well, I'm going to try and find kills as often as possible.
But is he going to kill Puck?
Is
Puck a hero that you kill by charging?
With Avalanche Toss, possibly.
Okay, if the timing's right, but if Puck gets any sense that he's being charged, he definitely doesn't need to die ever.
And actually, coming to that, I'm wondering where they put the Tiny Wisp. Because a lot of Southeast Asian teams have been running it safe lane. And not necessarily putting it into that mid. Then you've got the Queen of Pain. I know QQ has been playing offlane quite a lot of the time, but now that they've lost Johnny and they've replaced, or they've brought back Jesse Vash, an old school Mineski player, whether or not they switch up roles. Jesse Vash and Jay making your way back into Mineski.
I think that the Ancient Apparition and Rubik, this game on Rave, are going to have to do a really good job staying behind the scenes once the lane stage ends. Because it's interesting, we've got the Spirit Break and Quap to go on someone, and Wisp to bring Tiny in. And we saw that earlier in a series, the global strategy. Anti-Mage can blink away, Batrider will be able to blink, Puck will be able to blink, they're gonna, you know, move into those blink daggers. But Rubik and AA, if you get caught by a charge or Queen of Pain and the Relocate comes in, you are dead, definitely. And so I think that as soon as the lane stage ends, Ninja Boogie and Cast are gonna be trying to just take a back seat and not show a lot on the map.
Yeah, stand behind your tier 1, tier 2 towers. Let Chrissy hide in the fog, get a lasso on someone. But even this Witch Doctor is going to cause a lot of havoc. Kask up against Batrider is super annoying to deal with. If Anti-Mage is jumping forward, this game is down to the laning phase. Because if Mineski get an early lead, they can continue snowballing out of control. And I don't know if Rave have the heroes that can play defensively against this.
Is this Batrider going to die? He's being charged.
Boots. I think he's fine. Yeah.
They'll know there's a ward up, and they've actually pinged up pretty much the exact spot where it is, so I wonder if they'll bard some sentries early. Only thing is, because they have a Wisp, you can basically count on the Wisp rushing a battle. You almost always know that that's what's going to happen, so early sentries not as likely.
Chilling Touch? Are they going to contest Rune with this? Looks like they are. That increased magical damage is definitely going to be a threat, but Ryo's getting charged. Mineski? Running into this! The Chilling Touch damage is absolutely massive, though. Jay dropping to really low HP, but Ryo's in the back lines. Gets taken out first! Chrissy trying to find a kill onto Jay, but he just can't do it. QQ now turns back onto... He's got Napalm. He doesn't have Firefly. Who got the Badger Rune in the end, though?
Chrissy got it.
So Dire got both Badger Runes, but they lose First Blood. On the puck of all heroes.
Yeah, probably thinking Chilling Touch meant that they couldn't be contested, but you've got a Paralyzing Cost because you've got an Avalanche. Spirit Breaking can get there. It was 5v3, I think, or 5v4.
But I think the big problem was, I didn't see where Puck went to, but he orbed and jaunted into the middle of five heroes. The actual middle.
He was actually trying to dodge the Paralyzing Cask. I think he might have actually dodged it. But yeah, then he was stuck in the middle of everyone. Not a great place to be.
So Queen of Pain probably going to have a good time here. The fact that she's just a little bit ahead of Ryo in terms of experience. She's level 2. She's a level ahead of this Puck already. So Blink, no Shadow Strike. That's an interesting one.
Well, she used Scream in that early fight, so I think she just wants to get the blink up. But in that top lane, Jayo's already basically last hitting and denying every single creep, and JC Vash actually ran back to base after that first fight, so hasn't actually been at the lane yet.
And as you say, he lasts every creep. I've watched him miss too. Oh no. He's letting it slip.
Oh, under the tar, it's going to be a little bit harder at this stage in the game.
Yeah, with no Quelling Blade either. Anti-Mage is one of those awkward heroes with, you know, not quite enough base damage and then too much base damage. So it does come down to a lot of the time the actual damage output of the tower.
But ultimately, I think doing a good job because his supports did a creep pull there. And look where the creeps are. I mean, holding the equilibrium despite doing a creep pull is... Some teams struggle to do that. I mean, it's not always the most straightforward thing. And he's managed to do it just perfectly.
Yeah, without taking any harass as well, because with certain heroes, you know, you see people sort of running the creep wave around and just running back and forth to try and draw the creep wave so it lands there. But he brought it all the way back to the tower, so he didn't take too much damage and get harassed down. He's still afraid of what the Spirit Breaker can do one versus one. Jesse Vash charging onto... Wait, who? Who's he charging onto?
Chrissy in the bot lane.
I couldn't see the animation. Chrissy probably not going to drop to that Maledict, but he'll go pretty low. Yeah, down to about 60, 70 HP.
Yeah, I wanted to actually say during the picks, Witch Doctors these days leveling the Maledict really early, and I think that goes really, really well with the Queen of Pain. If you get a high level Maledict on someone in Queen of Pain, Sonic Waves and Screams, they're dead. Doesn't matter who they are, doesn't matter what their HP is, they're definitely going to die through that.
Ryo, almost 3 minutes in, doesn't have his bottle yet.
Which is pretty weird, right? He had an advantage coming into this fight. And he didn't get the first blood, but he got a little bit of gold being near the first blood. Some XP. Oh, sorry, wait, I'm talking about...
Queen of Pain.
Yeah.
Yeah, I clicked on her. How does she not have her bottle?
Yeah, that's why I thought you were talking about her, because neither of them have bottles. They did both start with the Null. So that's probably the explanation for why the bottles are a bit slower, because they didn't actually do bottle rushes.
How does this work? Because the Puck is like three last hits ahead. The Queen of Pain was a level ahead of the Puck. Got some assist gold from the First Blood. She bought some tangos, but surely that doesn't slow you down that much. Linking forward now is getting the scream down onto Ryo. But trading a hit here against the Puck is never easy when you're on the low ground and he's on the high ground.
So there's been a calculated decision from Mineski this game that... We don't mind if Anti-Mage gets free farm, as long as our Tiny also gets free farm. And I think that's an interesting call. It looks like Jayo's actually picked up Gloves of Haste. Oh, Jay, sorry, not Jayo, it's Jay versus Jayo. Jay's picked up Gloves of Haste, so this Tiny's going to be going for a Midas. Try and keep up with the farm of the Battle Fury Anti-Mage, but I'm not so sure. I think the Tiny's a lot better than the Anti-Mage in the super late game. But I think the Anti-Mage is going to get out of control a lot faster than the Tiny if they're both free farming.
I'm surprised about the Midas. It gives you some nice attack speed, which obviously... Oh, mid lane. Puck getting ripped apart. Queen of Pain and the Spirit Breaker jumping in there. But Anti-Mage needs Battle Fury, sure, to increase his farm rate. Tiny Aghanim's gives him pretty much the same thing. Why would you go for a Midas to try and build up into an Aghanim's faster? If you're free farming bot lane... So often we see European players like Era go for treads into possibly Bracer if you feel you need it, and then straight into Aghanim's. With a Wisp, you've got the attack speed, you've got the tank ability. You don't need the extra experience and gold.
I think it's just feeling the pressure of that anti-mage is free farming, he's gonna get super strong. We need some kind of... But as you say, I mean, the Aghanims itself is a farming tool, so... Yeah. It's not clear why you need to get the Midas on Tiny.
And, like, the timing of it as well, because you're looking at, what, a 5:30 Midas by the time it actually gets to him. And then the first use is going to be 5:30 or 5:45, depending on where, like, if he uses it on lane or if he has to head over to the jungle. Whereas he could have half of his Aghanims, or he could have treads completed, and then building up into the Aghs. Stacking up the camps for him, that's a nice boost of gold. Because you just run in and you avalanche toss, and that's a good 500 gold there, straight off the bat. Talking of bat, Chrissy is running over RR. One sticky napalm and Firefly. He's got the lasso as well.
Where on earth is Jesse Vash busy charging?
On to Chrissy. Yeah, I kept getting this bug where he was charging onto Chrissy, but I didn't see the animation above the Batrider.
Yeah, that's what I just said.
Witch Doctor's gonna die. The Spirit Break is still coming in, though. Oh, what? Gonna have to tether up Jay here to try and turn this around. Yeah, Chrissy, avalanche, toss, and dead.
So, a bigger kill for Mineski there, but their Queen of Pain goes down in the mid lane at the same time, and I think that was a... Was that a solo? Rubik looks like he was involved, yeah.
Also, another thing, I know I keep going about this Midas for Jay, but he bought the Gloves of Haste first. He didn't buy the recipe, bring it to him, and then go to the side shop to buy the Gloves of Haste, which is the, you know, slightly more efficient way of doing things, because you don't have to wait for the courier to actually travel to you. Is the Gloves of Haste just against this Batrider who's slowing you down and annoying you when you're trying to last hit creeps?
I guess, and Tiny does have especially slow attack speed, so maybe thoughts help him get a few more hits off, I'm not sure.
Well, Queen of Pain feeling the heat at this mid lane with the Rubik moving in, Ninja Boogie with boots and smoke. And Jo playing super aggressively on his top lane, going past the tier 1 even. He's got Treads, Quelling Blade and Ring of Health. It's a pretty standard build there for anti-mages nowadays. When you get Treads first with the Quelling Blade and Ring, instead of going for the Brown Boots Battle Fury, you can technically farm faster. Because you can go into the jungle and get some jungle creeps and push out the lane, jungle, push out the lane, and then keep doing that cycle over and over again, you can get Treads at a faster time, well, at a pretty damn fast time, and only miss out on like a minute and a half or 2 minutes of your Battle Fury timing. Then you have Battle Fury and Treads.
Smoking into mid lane, there's about to be an attempt here.
Well, Chrissy has found RR in the back end. Rio goes up onto high ground and takes down the Witch Doctor. Chrissy has been charged up, but they can't really turn this around. So again, they find a kill on the support. Jesse Vash has to cancel his charge, but he'd already reached the river. Overall, with a kill score 3-3, it still feels like Rave are getting the better trades.
Yeah, I can just see Anti-Mage getting his Battle Fury, getting his Manta, maybe one more item, and then just being uncontrollable and snowballing to the win. If the game does go long enough, sure, the Tiny is actually going to be a lot stronger, I think. But I don't see what Mineski have to slow down the Anti-Mage. This game just seems like it's going to progress exactly how he wants it to.
Yeah, I could understand if Queen of Pain was getting a quick Orchid, and she goes and hunts down the AM. But at this rate, AM's going to have Manta and Battle Fury by the time Co-op gets any item. She's just going to buy Treads next, and then she'll be delayed even more.
And this Batrider, Chrissy's nearly got Blink, and then Quap's probably going to die a few more times.
And that gives room for Rio on this Puck to build up his Blink Dagger, about 1,000 gold away from it. Jo once again playing aggressively into Jesse Vash, burning through that mana, just making sure that he's keeping tabs on the Spirit Breaker, knowing that he's not charging onto Batrider, onto Puck, or anything like that.
Well, Jay has been farming some stacks, so that's one mechanic they've been using, that the Tiny can farm the jungle a bit earlier than the Anti-Mage. The Anti-Mage, sure, you're right, he can farm the jungle, but quite slowly. He can't farm a stack until he has Battle Fury, that's for sure.
One camp at a time. His attack speed does allow him to do it pretty quickly, but he still takes a fair bit of damage. He has to go back and regen up, and it's usually when you have a free lane at top that you do this. You push the lane out, and you lose HP in the jungle, but you don't mind that much because Ring of Health just allows you to regen. If you're being harassed down by someone and if, you know, Spirit Break is charging at you, Queen of Pain makes a rotation up top, that's when things start looking dangerous. In fact, looking towards mid, Queen of Pain and Witch Doctor are prepping themselves for something here. I don't know if RR is waiting behind Quap defensively or if they want to go aggressively into this Puck Rubick. They don't even know Rubick's there.
And Chrissy's waiting with Jayo, just expecting the Spirit Break, and I think he might go right now.
Yeah, Chilling Touch, lasso him back, they know charges on cooldowns, so that's going to be a quick and easy kill. Even throwing out the Mana Void, why not? So Jayo going to buy...
no damage.
Oh, that's interesting. Oh, Queen of Pain finds the Puck kill? With a DD, okay. So I guess the Puck used the orb aggressively and couldn't jaunt back to it or something like that. But Jayo's item build, that interests me. Usually we see, you know, Claymore built at base and sent out to you. And then you can buy the broadsword now in the side shop. But in fact, he's got the broadsword in base.
Yeah, that is pretty interesting. It's maybe just because he had the gold for it and he was in the middle of a fight and he thought it's the slightest chance that they might kill me now. I don't know, just spend my unreliable gold.
Jesse just goes in there, takes a couple of tower hits. He doesn't care too much with the amount of HP he has. Oh, the Queen of Pain has an invis. Cast doesn't have tangos, but he's out hiding in the trees. Queen of Pain, oh, really?
Well, he knows.
He's like, guys, I think I'm dead here, actually.
That's actually a pretty relevant kill, I think, because the air is quite close to level 6. And I think once you have that air ulti up, the Batrider or Pack can much more easily go on people and just make pseudo solo kills with the ALT. Yeah.
Also, he was sitting on, what, 1200 gold? He was getting closer and closer to that Midas recipe. And a 13-minute Midas on AA is absolutely big.
Yeah, no, I think... I'm not sure. Sometimes you see the AA skip the Midas and just go straight for the Ags. Other times you see the Ags rush. I'm not actually sure what I like more. I think it probably depends on, as you say, like how easily you can get the Midas.
It doesn't look too difficult this game. He hasn't had to do too much work defending Jayo. And Ninja Boogie's been heading towards mid. Jayo has had pretty much a free lane up here on top. But how's Jay doing down on bot? He is now halfway... So 11 and a half minutes in, he has Treads, Midas, and halfway to Aghanim's. So I guess the fact that he's also had free farm, 91 last hits, he's 5 ahead of the AM. And also the fact that he hasn't taken the tier 1 tower at bot yet. He has got a lot of gold yet to farm.
And his net worth is even bigger than the anti-mages because a lot of the creeps he's farming are big jungle creeps. I think that's the thing maybe I missed when I was discussing that the anti-mage was going to go faster than him. Is that this Wisp is just keeping the Tiny on full mana all the time. And every time these camps spawn, they go farm all three of them. Every single time.
Yeah, it's pretty much exactly what I thought the anti-mage would do, but more effective on the Tiny. You're pushing the lane into the tier 1, so it's getting its HP chipped away. Go back into the jungle, but instead of taking one camp, like you said, they're taking stacks. They're taking 3 camps. They're taking 5 camps.
Yeah, and the Wisp really just enabling that. Of course, the anti-mage, once he has battle 3, is going to be doing all the camps on his own all the time. But hey, that's part of the package. That's why you pick Wisp. Top lane, Nasso, AA ulti. This should be another kill on Jesse Vash.
Yeah, he gets another strike down on Jayo. The Sonic Wave and Scream going to bring him low. Queen of Pain, Blinks 4. They finish off the anti-mage. QQ now in a pretty rough situation, but he's got Blink back off cooldown in a second. Puck with the orb, they've got Dream Coil. Can he get it though? Looks like he can. Onto one, not onto two though. Not quite catching the Witch Doctor as Ryo looks for this kill. A snap! Finishes off the Queen of Pain as he blinks away.
And that's Puck's blink.
Easy, Katka.
So the only bad thing there for Rave is the anti-mage dies and he was about 100 off his Claymore. Now he still needs another 300 to get to the Battle Fury. I mean, I think if the Tiny gets massive before the anti-mage, that's really problems for Rave.
Well, how long until Tiny just looks to start relocating and killing people, taking down towers? Oh, mid lane. They've got the toss down onto Ninja Boogie, not finishing him off though. Tiny Whisper in an awful situation as Tiny gets dropped by Jayo. Now the Mana Void, there's going to be 3 going down here. Ryo with a triple kill. And that's Jayo's Battle Fury completed. I think what you were just saying there was pretty spot on until Mineski run into a tier 1 tower and lose 3 heroes for nothing.
Yeah, and cast hits. The ancient apparition hit Ice Blast on all 3 of them. Which is pretty massive in determining how that fight went, I think.
cast with an Ogre Club. So he is going straight into that Aghanim. He's not going for the Midas. But Jay, he was so close. All he had to do was farm for another 2 minutes and he had Aghanims. He had the lead over the anti. Like, he still has a 900 net worth lead. But he could be pushing that to 3,000 or 4,000 ahead of the AM at this point.
We see it so much though. It's the natural dynamic. It's the way that a Dota player thinks, right? We've gone a bit ahead. Let's, like, increase our advantage. Let's, you know, we just want to fight. Let's quickly make this pickle. And what's happening in this patch is that because the team that goes ahead is constantly, like, taking these small risks to try to go further ahead, every now and then they pay for it, and then the game evens again.
That wasn't just a small risk, though. That was sending your tiny wisp, bot lane, in the raiding jungle. Jay gets caught out. Relocate save will send him back to base and keep him alive. Wisp, does he give up his life here? Does Rave actually back out? Looks like they want to kill.
Enders.
Oh, they're going to bring the tiny back, actually. QQ is standing here, posturing forward, like, yep, come on then, fight into us.
But the reason I called it a small risk is just because it looked a lot like they could get an easy Rubik kill. Just go on the Rubik, get out. But actually, the Rubik lived.
No, Rio! Doesn't jaunt to the orb, but that's dominating streak taken by the Tiny. But it was two cores and a support. It was the Tiny Wisp combination, diving a tier 1. Just like, it is just a Rubik kill. What does that Rubik kill give you?
Yeah, I suppose that's the point I'm trying to make. To them, it's like, it's just a Rubik kill, but that means it's really easy, in and out. And the problem is when it isn't really easy, when the Rubik doesn't die, when the other team gets to react.
Two towers denied in a row by Rave as well. But there's Axe Tiny. 16 minutes in, Midas treads Aghanims and Quelling Blade. He's going to start tearing through the jungle. Antimage, though, Jayo has already started doing that.
Yeah, I don't know what to say right now. I'm not sure who farms faster, because the Wisp is helping the Tiny do all the jungle camps because he's got a Midas. I think the Tiny might just keep up, maybe even stay ahead of the Anti-Mage. And then we got a question of, you know, how long does the game go? What kind of fights are we looking for? Sure, if Tiny gets picked off, no buyback, that's really good for Rave, but it's difficult to see a 5v5 going Rave's direction.
Yeah.
If Tiny's alive and everyone's there.
I think the biggest factor farming-wise is Tiny can do Ancients straight away. With Aghanims, he can do Ancients. Whereas Antimage doesn't have the HP pool to really sustain through it. He can take one camp, maybe, but he drops like a third of his HP and then he's susceptible to Queen of Pain finding him or something like that. And even now, Mineski picking out, let's start blocking up this Ancient camp. Because once that's stacked up and Antimage gets Vlads or Yasha, that's when he can go into the Ancients and actually clear them out. Whereas Tiny has two stacks on top of the regular spawn.
Yeah, it's definitely going to be interesting. I think, again, I want to say that AA's ulti might be a big playmaker for Rave at this point in terms of winning a fight. It's difficult to see what else is meant to be doing the work and winning them the fight. I mean, Antimage with Battle Fury is definitely not going to be one to be fighting it. And Pak and Rubik and AA have all smoked down to the bot lane. They're going to, I guess, go for a pick-off on the Witch Doctor.
Four-man smoke and what, two ultis gonna get thrown out? Ice Blast, then Puck, he doesn't have to use Dream Claw, just blink in and nuke. So, one ulti, not really too much expanded, and that ulti's on a 40-second cooldown. So then they can turn this into a tier 1 bot, unless the relocate comes in. I could see this happening very shortly. Just Jesse on the Spirit Breaker, charge onto someone, wait until you're 3/4 of the way there, then relocate in and try and take someone down.
The reason they're not defending is that Queen of Pain is extremely close to Orchid, and so okay. She doesn't want to TP in.
So they'll be able to take down this large camp. Tiny going in and stealing one with the Midas, but that
yeah,
creep would
have
given.
They're just gonna go for the trade.
Yeah. Will it get traded even? Because mid lane, Jesse Vash, they found Jo. The relocate back in Avalanche, but the blink out. They tossed the Wisp across. Jo gets slowed down, but it didn't really work out how they wanted. Now Puck looking for the kill on Wisp. Chrissy not getting the last two onto anyone, but a couple more right clicks finishes off Io, and the rest of Mineski escape. That must have scared the shit out of Jo, getting jumped on like that so quickly.
I think they stacked something. I feel like Charge, Nether Strike, and Avalanche, between those three should be enough for them to actually DPS him down.
Yeah.
I think that the Nether Strike and the Avalanche were a bit stacked. and that's why they didn't get the last, you know, one or two hits to actually kill Joe.
Can they kill Tiny at top? He's got no Wisp, he's got no help. No, he's not going to get hit by the Ice Blast, though. Turns back around to J.O. Avalanche smashes him down into the ground, drops to half HP. They still have the last two, though. Telekinesis and then the disable from Chrissy. J.O. just rip... Well, he was ripping into him until the craggy exterior turns it back and stuns him up. Jay still goes down, though.
Yeah, that's what we were speaking about before. I mean, Tiny is probably a lot more formidable than Anti-Mage. But it depends on his Wisp being there.
Jesse Vash has been doing this over and over again. See Anti-Mage, charge Anti-Mage, don't stop until I hit Anti-Mage.
Yeah, this reminds me of the Isis Ice Spirit Breaker, who's just being a nuisance. I mean, it almost feels like he wants people to TP there thinking they're all going on Anti-Mage. Like, his plan is to just go there and then run away and confuse the enemy team, make them, you know, move somewhere for no reason.
Yeah, force a blink, force mana users, just... try and bait out as many spells or movements as you can. Cast on the spot lane, gets the haste rune. Does he have something on the courier? No. He is looking pretty damn poor with that one ogre club. Jesse not getting another strike. The relocate's coming in though. Rio's going to be able to... Oh, he gets awkward enough. Queen of Pain with the silence, but there's no follow. Nothing to actually continue the fight. Wisp going to drop to the Batrider Firefly and another right click. Once again... Mineski go in with the attempted relocate gang, but it just doesn't work.
Yeah, that's... it's a bit strange. You'd think that with Pack and Batrider on Rave, they'd be the ones trying to make pickoffs, and the Wisp would be used reactively to cover, and actually it seems like that's not happening. Mineski's the ones who feel desperate to make kills for some reason, and Rave constantly getting to react.
I guess it's because they got Spirit Breaker and Queen of Pain. They want to make something happen with those heroes. They are very pick-off oriented, and the fact you've just built... like, Orchid is completed. You've not really done anything with it. But if... I feel they just need, like, two wards in the enemy jungle. Have a Radiant Ward here watching the large camp, and then have another, you know, ward over here watching the movement between medium camp and the actual lane. If you have those two wards, you have the entire jungle... free for the Tiny to steal from the Anti-Mage. You've got possible kills on the AM with charge, relocate. All you need is some aggressive warding.
Who is Queen of Pain going to Orchid? Because Bat's got his 4-staff and Pac's got his Yule, so is it just Anti-Mage? He's going to have Mantis soon.
Must just be Anti-Mage. AA and Rubick are, you know, they're okay targets. You can silence them up and kill them, but there's no one really to Orchid and really limit their potential in teamfights.
Well, Anti-Mage has already got Yasha, so, I mean, it's going to be like a minute or two and he's going to have Mantis Star, and then everyone you want to Orchid as a way to deal with it.
Very difficult indeed. Charge, still onto the puck, but this is one you cancel.
I feel like this might be a game where Queen of Pain wants to get a Hex Rush and not an Orchid Rush, I'm not sure. Part of the reason that the Orchid Rush is favored is that it's also a combat item, and Queen of Pain with that now really reduced base attack time. She is kind of she's a semi-carry, she's not just a spellcaster.
Yeah, she's got decent stat gain, and it's why quite often we see later on Queen of Pain's build things like Mjolnir, MKB. Her right-click attacks really do hurt.
But in terms of just the activatable on the Orchid, it's just not going to be even close to what a Hex would do in this game.
Yeah. Roshan being taken here by Rave. Pretty much, Mineski are unaware of what's going on in here. Do they actually have no idea?
Yep. Looks like it. I mean, there's no ward that would have seen it, and just casually farming.
Well, like, they had the ward up on the high ground, but Rave smoked in.
Oh, did they?
Well, I'm assuming so. Because... surely they would have seen it, because they took this path down.
Well, yeah,
anyway,
okay.
Mineski either letting it go or not knowing it's happening. Batrider going forward, Lasso's Jay back. J.O. is here as well. First hit Craggy, but they've still got enough damage with the Ice Blast ticking him over. Avalanche thrown out there to add insult to injury as the Wisp. You want to be doing this as Tiny Wisp, you know, split pushing a lane and having the rest of your team somewhere else. But if your team aren't posturing to fight, if you're not forcing the issue with the other three team members, and making Rave think, well, we've got to fight into these three, or else they're going to take a tower, they're going to take Roche, they're going to take our jungle, or they're going to kill us all. Then Tiny Wisp having Relocate is almost useless.
Rave are just playing better right now. They're outplaying Mineski at pretty much every turn. And I guess that experience showing, because this Mineski lineup is quite newly formed, right? The Rave team's been together for a while and it's been doing really well recently.
Who wins this matchup? QQ gonna get used up. Rio was silenced. Now Ice Blast. Oh man, does Puck just go back in? Guess the silence and nuke down onto RR. JO gonna finish off this kill. Ice Blast, in fact. Gonna get triggered by the Batrider. Oh, I thought maybe the Queen of Pain dies there.
Chrissy really doing a good job on this Batrider and just showing us yet again why he does sometimes move to the offlane. I've only seen him offlane on this hero, but I think I've also only seen him win with it. Actually want to go check that. Just check stats on Chrissy's Batrider.
Stats time! Let's go over these items, in fact. Well, Anti-Mage has now overtaken the Tiny by about 700 net worth. So the Tiny had about, what, 2,000, 2,500 lead. But that's been taken back by Jo, who now has Manta, Battle Fury, 3,000 gold, in fact. Next up for him, I don't know. What do you go up against? Tiny Wisp, Queen of Pain, Spearbreaker. BKB seems decent, but then you've still got Sonic Wave, Death Ward, and Tiny's right clicks. Abyssal Blade against the Tiny, so you can just jump in and bash him. Butterfly.
Looks like Chrissy's Batrider is 5-2 in this patch. Not bad. I'm not sure what you go. J.O.
Charged up. Nether Strike. He's still got Aegis Immortal though. So he'll come back to life and the rest of his team are incoming. Blink forward and lasso on the J. He does not have the luxury of another life. He's going to die here. J.O. man for Wisp with the Relocate save, but they're going to find more. QQ blinks out back to the tier 2 tower. BKB was used there by Chrissy. They're going to get, at the very least, a Wisp kill.
Yeah, do they come back in? Do Mineski try to fight this? They got 5, potentially.
I don't think so.
Yeah. Looks like that's a no.
Career, okay. Not sure what that was doing there. Courier pretty much walks into Rave and pays with its life. BKB nearly done for Jesse Vash, but Spirit Breaker isn't really a hero that does a hell of a lot at this stage of the game.
Spirit Breaker does almost nothing at this stage in the game. It sets up charge into ulti to disable someone.
He basically...
If the Anti-Mage doesn't have Aegis, maybe they kill him. But now he's got BKB.
Yeah. This is what I was wondering. I was asking, what does he buy? Every single item seems suboptimal. BKB is the only real one where you think, okay, well, I survive through Avalanche Toss and I'll get stunned or bashed up. I take a bit of damage, but I think that's the best item he could have gone for. Spirit Breaker?
I think so, as well.
He basically just gives vision. He charges someone so that Queen of Pain and Tiny know who to go on. He's like a big... you know, red arrow, pointing at the target that they need to go on.
Tiny's also got his BKB, just at the base, since the courier just died. So a lot of BKBs coming out at the same time. And one thing that's going to be interesting with the BKBs is that Ryo on the pack is building into an Ags. Very, very close to an Ags, and that pack Ags, pretty solid tool against BKBs.
Yeah, I really like the buff they did to it. There was a lot of talk on Reddit. You know, talking about Ags upgrades and how Pux was almost completely useless if they gave him some kind of buff against... Oh man, Ryo. He sees the Tiny and he's like, well, I'm out of here. Unfortunately though, the Queen of Pain didn't make the same movement. If Crop had blinked at the same time as Tiny showed himself, they could potentially just kill the Pux straight up there.
Yeah, so we've had a bunch of BKB pickups and we're heading towards a bunch of Ags pickups, I think. AA is about 1,000 off his Ags. Pux got Ags now. I think we see Queen of Pain about to get Ags as well.
And level 11 almost done on the AA as well. That's pretty important. Gem has been purchased for them just to try and keep the vision up. And try and limit the vision of Mineski. Mineski have finally, put some deep wards into the dire jungle, but it just feels too little too late. JO has passed the farming phase and he's now in the fighting phase. This is when Anti-Mage wants to fight. He doesn't want to sit in the jungle for 15 minutes. He doesn't want to farm stacked camps. He wants to go and kill you. Oh, Blink Lasso finding the Witch Doctor. Quick and easy kill there. Ice Blast even launched as well. But how do you stop this as Mineski? You've got Tiny Wisp, but you haven't done anything with them. Every single relocate gank has failed. Maybe this one, though. Onto Rubik, of all people. Dreamcall even launched down onto the Tiny. The double BKB from Jesse Fashion J does allow them to stand around a bit, but that is the Ags Dreamcoil. My tongue got twisted there with Rio's Ags. The charge going forward in the Sonic Wave finishes off the AM. I didn't see the Queen of Pain just making that move there.
That fight's pretty scary for Rave, because Tiny BKB and Anti-Mage BKB, they started hitting each other, and after about a second, JO was like, hang on, I'm not winning this fight. So, maybe Mineski now aware that that's what they need to do, just be fighting all together.
Yes.
The Anti-Mage doesn't kill the Tiny if they're standing there hitting each other. The Tiny's the one that definitely wins that fight.
Well, the regular play to, you know, way to play Tiny Wisp is to have those two heroes split pushing one lane. And you run down one lane and pressure the lane. You have the other three trying to force a fight somewhere else. And then you relocate in, so you're 5 versus 5. But yeah, I wonder if what you're saying is the right way to go. If you go 5 down one lane, what are you worried about? Anti-Mage split pushing? You've still got relocate to go and stop him from split pushing. So you can always use that as like a defensive tool to try and save your base.
And Tiny's going to be picking up a butterfly next, I think. And that's going to really just complete his... basically immunity to Anti-Mage. It's gonna be so hard for Anti-Mage to kill that Tiny on his own. A little bit of help from some friends maybe here, but if they're standing there hitting each other, I think Tiny wins that all there.
Witch Doctor, point booster, Aghanim's is a distant dream for him, but Jay continues farming angels.
Aghanim's is not a distant dream for Queen of Pain's already finished Aghanim, sorry. What about Ancient Apparition? It's also pretty far now. I thought he was a bit closer.
1400? Yeah, I thought he was like 1,000 gold away, but maybe he got to like 800, 900, then died in the last fight.
I don't... Did he die?
He's 3-1 and 8.
Did die.
Maybe he didn't. I don't know.
I think he must have just bought a bunch of wards and some smoke. I thought he was about 1,000 off as well.
Wait, where are the kills in that fight? Like, the
well,
last fight,
Rubik
died, but it doesn't show in the net worth graph. Huh? What?
I guess the graph decided that Rubik's not an important enough kill to display.
It doesn't show a big dip in net worth or anything like that, but... surely it should show every kill. Every tower destroyed. Where is the Rubik kill? Because it was here, wasn't it? Where that dip is. Where the sudden peak that goes back up to 8,000. That is where Rubik died. Because who else died? There was Anti-Mage as well. Anti-Mage died as well.
Yeah.
What?
Anti-Mage is busy getting another rush. And again, not going to be contested at all.
What the?
So this is something that's definitely working in Rave's favor this game. The rush on kills.
Apparently Mineski's kills aren't worth showing on the graph or something like that. Because, right, fair enough, the Rubik kill doesn't mean anything. But they killed AM when the Queen of Pain blinked up here and got the Orchid Sonic Wave down on them. That's bizarre. That is...
Oh, wait, now I see it.
Wait,
now... take a look, now I see...
What?
I see Tiny killed Rubik on the graph.
What?
The M ones.
But that's now. So is the graph delayed? That doesn't make any sense.
Must be a little bit delayed.
But it says 33 minutes and 21 seconds is when they killed AM. Right now it's 33 minutes and 20 seconds. Okay, the graph is all of a sudden jumping around and going crazy. I'm just going to close it and say Ghost did it. Because what? Jay is pushing up on this top lane with Wisp just behind him. The Wisp has to be very careful about positioning here. Like, they're pinging out right now. The Wisp and Tiny are going to go back and farm the jungle and try and make some efficient plays here. Wisp is dead. Wisp is dead. He's got relocate, but he's just gonna get stunned up and nuked down by the ice blast.
Rubik's stealing that tether. I was gonna ask. He's picked up a blink and a yule, so Rubik's quite mobile. What's the ideal thing for him to steal, you think?
Sonic wave.
Doesn't get better than that, does it?
I don't think so. Like, he doesn't get the Ags upgrade of Sonic Wave, does he? Until he gets Ags.
Not unless he has his own, yeah.
Is
Tether useful? Like, is he happy to have Tether?
Tether isn't really that good unless you have Overcharge. Because it's not like Rubik is healing himself up. Like, he's got Urn, he's got decent mana regen, I guess. What else do you give? It's not really that good. Movement speed? Allow J.O. to chase further forward? Yeah, J.O. even pops BKB for this one. QQ comes in with the Orchid down onto the Rubik, but J.O. spots the Tiny and says, I don't want to fight up against this Rockman.
Okay, so using the Manta and the BKB.
Oh, Jesse was charging in there. The Relicate's going to come in, though. Tiny Wisp trying to smash down the Batrider. Sonic Wave flying across nobody, in fact. Puck has been silenced up by QQ here, and it's going to get avalanched down. J.O. returns into the fight. Brings down the Wisp, but he's going to get taken out. Can they kill him a second time? They don't have Orchid. He does have Manta. So regardless of what they actually did there, he turns back onto QQ. Pops BKB. Now the Orchid in charge. J.O. silenced up. He's got to blink in a second, but I don't know. Can he survive through it? The toss perfectly timed. Killed twice. And that's Mineski really showing how strong this Tiny Wisp is.
Yeah, I feel like where things are going well for Rave, it's because they're actually outplaying Mineski, but when they get forced into like a full-on confrontation, there's no outplaying to do, right? The heroes on Mineski are just stronger than theirs, and they're going to keep losing these fights. If it's a fair fight, it goes to Mineski, I think.
Does Anti-Mage consider buying back here? Because the rate at which your towers and racks are going to fall, Glyph is available, but that doesn't last too long. Tiny is going to take tier 3 in racks here if Anti-Mage doesn't buy back, or if there's some serious defense mounting from Rave. Okay, they've got the last two down to Jay. He's tethered up, but now he's in the middle of the base. Stunned up and locked down. The Death Ward's placed and fires onto Chrissy as Jay turns back and destroys the tower. Ryo blinks forward, yules himself and dodges the Sonic Wave, but Jay's probably going to have something to say about this. The yules again from Ninja Boogie, sending Jay up into the air.
So the Raxes survive without the AM buyback, but I'm not so sure about that, because if the AM did buyback and they caught the Tiny with the Cold Feet, Lasso, all the disabled together, maybe Tiny actually dies there. So would it be worth it if AM had bought back and killed Tiny? Is that a good reason to buy back?
I don't know. He's on 6,000 gold. What's his next item? Okay, Abyssal Blade. He's going to go for the Abyssal, but if Anti-Mage had bought back and gone into that fight, holy shit, really? Jay picking up a basher of his own. This is one of the scarier prospects. If Anti-Mage didn't have that BKB, I would be incredibly annoyed if I were him. Because you're walking into Jay, who has Craggy exterior and basher. If you're fighting one versus one, there's no way Anti-Mage wins.
I think there's basically no way Anti-Mage wins.
Regardless, yeah.
It's, yeah. I'm a bit worried for Rave. They have to outmaneuver Mineski at this point in time. They're not gonna win that straight up fight. I see Ryo's getting pretty close to Hex. Well, got an ultimate orb, but just passed halfway to the Mystic Star. A Hex could do a lot of work.
They've got Hex to on the Batrider.
Oh wow, so they already got one and they're getting close to another. So if they chain Hex, locked on Tiny before he BKBs, that's one way they could maybe win a fight.
But how do they push these lanes in? Because that's the one thing they've been struggling with, is the fact that Anti-Mage has to be with his team in these fights. He has to be moving with the rest of the squad. He can't be off on one lane just pushing out, controlling the creep equilibrium as they want to. He has to be there, ready to join. Because if he's not, he's going to get soloed out by the Tiny Relocate, or, you know, something's going to happen where Mineski's positioning and the charge giving vision. We were saying that Spirit Breaker isn't that useful this late in the game. After like 25 minutes, he's not He's not that hero that you expect to win the game for you. But he still offers you the vision. He's still tanky as all hell with 2,000 HP, BKB. And he can lock down the Anti-Mage for a number of seconds.
Yeah, and it's pretty simple for Mineski right now. The job of every player on their team that isn't Tiny is to make sure Tiny doesn't die. And Tiny will do the rest. He can kill everyone, definitely. So they just need to, you know, draw some attention to themselves, disable some people, maybe get rid of a support in the backline. If Tiny lives, they win the fight.
Well, Wisp knows his positioning is key, so he's going to be standing as far back as possible. Queen of Pain wants to push out this mid lane as Rave, do you smoke up? They tried smoking just now, but couldn't really find anything from it. Throwing out Ice Blast. They've got charge onto Ninja Boogie at bot, actually. Spirit Breaker might just go for the solo kill. Are they... Really? Did you think that would work? Jesse Vash is getting dominated by Jo, but that TP out from Ninja Boogie was always going to happen before you relocate in. Always.
Maybe they thought he'll panic and cancel it. I don't know. It doesn't really make sense.
Well, they've wasted relocate. They've wasted a little bit of time as well, where they could be farming enemy jungle, pushing out top lane, keeping the creep wave at mid past the river. But what are we looking at here? Batrider going for the courier and going for the witch doctor. The hex down is the RR. The BKB popped, but the abyssal blade from Tiny. Chrissy didn't stand a chance. Ice blast gonna hit two, but it doesn't hit the Tiny or Wisp. Jo, are you just gonna cut waves? No. Jumping to Ancients, running around, Mantra Illusions, probably going to try and cut this creep wave.
Yeah, this is now Mineski's game to lose. I mean, they're behind still on gold and XP and kills.
Every metric, Rave are behind.
But they're winning.
Sorry, not Mineski's Rave, Mineski.
They're behind on every metric, but they're far ahead. Actually,
yeah, it's again. Oh, mid lane, not mid lane, top lane. Puck jumping in. Don't know why the hell I said mid. Probably because Puck jumped into the middle of a couple of people. I was like, oh, there we go. Dream Course drop. Sonic Wave was stolen by Ninja Boogie there. The Anti Mage is taking down the Queen of Pain at the top. Hex now with the Jay. They've taken out Rex, but Rave are losing heroes at a drastic rate as Tiny is just cleaning through them all. Sans now. But it doesn't matter when you got Abyssal Blade on Jay. Locking down the puck for quite a while, and you'll stop into the air. Tiny's the last one alive. But they got their axe. Even if Rave can fight up like that, it requires Mineski to ignore their heroes, to hit buildings, and then fight. That's the only reason Rave could actually team wipe them there, is because Mineski literally said, okay, well, we're here to take Rax. We're not here to fight you. We just want to destroy your buildings. So there was a good, what, 5-6 seconds of that team fight where Tiny was hitting Rax. Queen of Pain was dying, but hitting Rax.
He had a 7-second BKB and he used the whole duration just to hit buildings. He wasn't interested in fighting. I mean, maybe one of the downsides of that is we could see Jo getting another Aegis. Does he have space for an Aegis even? I mean, there could be another rush kill. But we got buybacks.
I guess you dropped Vlad's for it?
Are Rave planning to force the buyback? Looks like it's...
Tiny might be scared? Oh, well, when Witch Doctor gets dragged back here by Chrissy, he's just going to lose his life for nothing. Standing there, accepted his fate. Buyback now from Tiny. Do they have the relocate? Where do they go? The pings are coming! Relocate? Okay, they found them. Anti-Mage is in the Roshan. Yeah, Ninja Boogie's going to get taken down here. Abyssal Blade up on him. Queen of Pain trying to find the puck. Gets the Orchid Science down onto Rio. Toss forward. The nuke damage has to come thick and fast because Puck has already used himself. Face shift and then blink. Can't blink? Doesn't blink. Dream Coil, but it gets taken out. Holds them in place. They need to give Anti-Mage more time. Wait. More? He's not killing. Roshan isn't alive. What? Jo? Now he blinks into fight. Takes down the Spirit Breaker. Roshan was taken. So Jo has Aegis Immortal, but fighting up against Jay is not possible. I looked into the pit and I just saw Anti-Mage there standing around doing nothing. I thought, wait, has Roshan not respawned yet? What's going on? And then I click on him and see as he's already taken it. Paying attention to what's happening on the left-hand side of the screen is difficult when there's fights going on.
Okay, so the advantage that Rave have now is the Anti-Mage's buyback, the Tiny doesn't. The Anti-Mage's Aegis, the Tiny doesn't. So even though Tiny's stronger than Anti-Mage 1v1, if Anti-Mage has 3 lives, well, maybe Rave win a fight. So I think that Mineski might want to be a bit cautious about forcing another push sometime soon. Maybe wait out the Aegis first.
I was just about to say, they were pinging out mid-racks. They just want to go in. XJ? Batrider? Pause? Now, I can... I don't know. 3 hits and the ranged Rax is dead. Jay tackling this up. He's got the cold feet on him as well. Stolen was Avalanche. Rubik returns that back on him. Jay still has his BKB though. Pop BKB, take Melee Rax. Or just get relocated back. So one relocate almost destroys a full lane of Rax.
Yeah, so I was saying they don't want to take a fight while Anti-Mage has 3 lives, but that's not even a fight. That's just, I mean, they're essentially backdooring. They could do that.
Yeah, that's a thing they can accomplish. Oh my god. That right there reminded me of, I think it was a year and a half ago, Na'Vi were playing up against Empire or someone like that, and Na'Vi had Tiny Wisp. They won a team fight and, you know, went 4-for-2 or something like that. They killed 4 and only lost 2. And then Tiny Wisp took the entire... Oh, man. Abyssal and Hex. Jay, does he lose his life here? Ice Blast and Lasso both on him. Jay are trying to do as much damage as he can. Rio comes in. Yep. Man of Void. Jay is down for 100 seconds now. Wisp has no one to tether to. He gets to a catapult, but he's probably going to die. Is this just game over? Does Rave win off the back of that?
Really, yeah. I think so. And... really just recklessness from Mineski. There's no reason to expose in that way. There's no reason to farm out there. Spotted out by a ward. Tiny used Flatter, by the way. I don't know if you saw. So he wasn't evading. Flattered to actually get to the Ancients.
Really?
Yep. And Wisp didn't have relocate ready yet. So just like risk after risk after risk, layering the map and being punished for it. And I mean, do Rave go for Megas or do they just go throw it?
Safest is go Megas, I guess. You're at the very least going to take 2 sets of Rax. And if Queen of Pain or someone moves forward to try and defend, you just blink on them and Abyssal Blade.
Well, I did say it was Mineski's game to lose, and they've looks like they've gone ahead and lost it.
Oh boy. So the pickoff potential there with the 2 Hexes on Puck and Batrider. Sonic Wave thrown out down onto Bat. Chrissy not going to die here to the Death Ward. But we'll die to one more right click. QQ gonna get stunned up by the telekinesis. But I don't know. They're running in now, desperately trying to find something, but Queen of Pain's dead. This is GG. That is actually game over right now.
Do we see one last relocate attempt into the enemy base here as soon as Tiny spawns? Because Anti-Mage has no way to get back. He has to run all the way back. So I wonder if Tiny respawns, they just go enemy base and like, kind of, let's see what we can do. This is all we've got.
Maybe, yeah. The one time in recent history that I've seen anyone defending up against Mega Creeps was Mindsanity with Tiny Wisp up against London Conspiracy. And they defended for a good 10-15 minutes against Mega Creeps. They even pushed out of their base to take Roshan. The only thing that stopped them from actually staying in the game was Skanks on LC was playing Lion, and while Tiny Wisp was taking Roche, he got a 2-man Earth Spike. Stole Roshan kill and stole Aegis Immortal. It was like the sickest play I've seen in so long, but it doesn't look like they're going to go in for tier 4s. They will stay in the game and defend though. Tiny Wisp is one of the very few combination of heroes that can even possibly think of defending against Megas.
I don't see a way they can win this game though, because everyone on Rave has buyback. So even if they were to win a big fight, then what? I mean, creeps start pushing into their base, they try to push, everyone buys back, and their base dies to creeps.
I don't know. Do you try and bait Rave into a fight somewhere, like near the Ancients or in your own jungle, then relocate Tiny Wisp in to try and just backdoor base? Because right now, all lanes are being pushed into Mineski's base. If they had one lane that was in Rave's base, I could see them doing this. Anti-Mage jumping forward. Jay's just dead. Gets relocated back, but he's on low HP, and that's relocate used.
That's a dead Wisp.
He does have Queen of Pain to tether to, but... wait.
What?
They don't kill him? That's interesting.
Hex is on cooldown, that's pretty why. both of their hexes on cooldown.
Maybe they thought Tiny was big fight. Yeah, maybe they thought Tiny was being brought back. Because if Tiny gets brought back there with, you know, BKB on him, no hexes to throw out, he could fight up against you, and you don't want to take that risk. Thanks to Nahas, we have another stat. Tiny Wisp is 43-29 in 6.83 matches that end before 40 minutes. They are only 17-16 in 40-plus minute matches. Ninja Boogie, hexed up, and the charge from Jesse Vash. Where's the reaction from Rave? Non-existent. I say that as Antimage jumps into the back, finds Jay with a lasso. Batrider holds him in place, but Jay on the death ward has to bail on this one. Chrissy, did Craggy really proc there? That wasn't a bash. Jay didn't hit him. That was Craggy, right?
I think so. Yeah.
But Bat wasn't hitting him.
I think if your hero like thinks about it, if you just near a Tiny, that sometimes happens. It's happened to me before in Dota games. I blink near Tiny and actually don't issue any attack command. I'm actually planning to attack someone else.
Yeah.
And just because my hero was like there and thought about Tiny, looked at him funny, got stunned.
Well, I guess it's the same as Axe as well. Even if you don't actually, or Centaur, even if you don't actually launch the projectile, if you've got auto attack on, then your hero will issue an auto attack command on the nearest target. So you could potentially just make the Axe spin, or make the return from the Centaur do damage to you, or the Craggy Exterior from the Tiny stun you up. Or are you talking about with auto attack turned off as well, it does it?
No, I do have auto attack on, so I'm not sure about with auto. But I'm interested in that stat you got us from Nahas, because it sounds like Tiny Wisp is more consistently successful before in the earlier games, the games that ended in 40 minutes. And that, to me, that's weird. I think this is a combo that's really good in the late game. Like, is that just because longer games are more volatile in general?
I guess it's for the same reason that we're seeing here. If Tiny dies and doesn't have buyback or anything, then there's nothing to fall back on. Unless you're... Oh, Jay. He go... Oh, dear.
So you're saying in a strategy with Tiny and Wisp, you usually don't have a secondary core that can fight without the Tiny?
Yeah. It's not like you pick up an Anti-Mage or something like that to fight with the Tiny as well. It's always about tempo controllers. Because you need the first 20 minutes to go pretty much in your favor so that you can farm the jungle, stack things up, and not have supports running around willy-nilly trying to save lanes. That really plays against the Tiny Wisp. So you need some kind of way to hold down the lanes, and having another farming core, or another farming carry, doesn't really play into that. Jay doesn't even get the melee racks. He does have buyback though.
Yeah, he's finally got his buyback back.
Yeah, he's gonna use it to defend base because Throne is dying to creeps. I don't know. Tiny, good luck, my friend. He's got boots of travel.
And I feel bad for the Mineski fans right now because they had this game. They really, truly had this game. I don't care what the metrics said. They had the game, and Tiny took a totally unnecessary risk farming ancients when the entire enemy team was off the map. When he used his Flatso and his Wisp couldn't relocate him out. And then it was just Megas.
Rod of Atos for the AA. Oh dear, Rave. You've got three lanes pushing in. Which one do you choose? Jump straight on the Quap, you've got Hexes, you've got Blinks, you've got Initiations, straight on there. Queen of Pain, probably going to get nuked down here. Jay turns back onto Jay, he's got that MKB now, so ripping through that evasion of the Butterfly. Death Ward is dropped, and does decent sustained QQ does an interesting blink, just helps forward a little bit. But that's a buyback from Quap. They've lost the Wisp, they've lost the Witch Doctor, and Rave are not going to lose a single hero. I take it back, they lose the Rubick. J.O. though is on the verge of taking the Ancient. Right clicking down Jay and forcing him back into the fountain. Jesse Vash is finding kills in the back end on the support, but Jay? Oh, he gets hexed up and can't finish off J.O., but the Craggy still procs. That is Tiny down for 2 minutes, and that is finally game over and a win for Rave at such an important time.
Anti-Mage brought back and he sold an item so he can get his travels. What did he actually sell? Doesn't matter. No difference at all.
Yeah. game still goes the way of Rave, thanks to those mega creeps. Ice Blast flying across our screen at the very last second. Yeah, I agree with you. It was Mineski's game, even though they were, what, like 5,000 net worth behind, 5,000 experience behind, 10 kills behind? They still had the Tiny Wisp with Aghanims. They were destroying racks in 3 or 4 hits. They had the map control, they had momentum on every single lane, and they had the route to win the game. They had a map that had a big X on it saying, game is won here. But for some reason, they didn't follow the path that was set for them, and they just ran towards Ancients, lost Tiny a couple of times, and Jayo with his anti-mage made short work of the racks and buildings.
Yep, and that's kind of what we see in this patch, that a lot of the time, whoever won the most recent fights is the team that's actually ahead, you know, like, sure, Mineski's winning, but as soon as Rave make their pick off on Tiny, suddenly they're winning, just like that.
Well, we'll be back with game number 2 in a couple of minutes between Rave and Mineski.